Trini Girl Natural.
Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. Today we're talking about ingredients. A lot of you subbies have been seeing me talk about ingredients when doing product reviews, and I've had quite a few requests to share some of my knowledge about ingredients with you guys, so here I am to try to do that. Of course, there's so many ingredients, it'll be really pretty much impossible to kind of cover every single thing. So what I'm going to do is try to group them into the basic classes, and hopefully that will help you spot and identify what they are, how to find out what they are, and which types of products need which type of ingredients. Get yourself certification, I guess, in natural hair product ingredients. So it's kind of a complicated topic just because there's so many types of ingredients, so many types of products, and just so many ways to class them. So I kind of combine classing the type of ingredient, the thing the ingredient does, and also the type of product that uses that ingredient. So hopefully it all comes together and makes sense. In terms of how I learn about ingredients, I learn about it the long, hard way, which is reading every label of every product that I'm interested in and going to Google and looking up every single ingredient. At first I would have to do it for every single product and then less and less, and now I hardly have to do it because I kind of remember or know what each type of ingredient does. So let's get started. But before we do, subscribe, click the notification bell, you know, support your girl, yeah. Alright, so on to the topic. This almost feels like it doesn't need to be said, but it needs to be said. Water is an ingredient. It's the main ingredient. We need water in our natural hair. We can't have healthy natural hair without water. The main function of water, of course, is to hydrate our hair. But as we know, it also helps to mix ingredients. And it's also useful for diluting, for example, diluting strong shampoos and so on. The main type of cleansing ingredient we use in natural hair is surfactants, the famous sulfates, which are kind of harsh. Then we have some middle type surfactants like decylglucoside, which still too harsh for me. And then cocobetaine, which is a mild but effective surfactant, and that's my favorite. That's the one that I use regularly to cleanse my hair. Those are synthetic surfactants. We have also some natural surfactants like soap nuts and yucca root. So the way the surfactant works basically is that it helps the water to bind to dirt in your hair, and then when you rinse off that water surfactant, the triplet, you know, you just rinse that off. Apple cider vinegar is not a surfactant and cannot do that. In terms of getting off your silicones, getting off your mineral oil and so on, get you a surfactant, not apple cider vinegar, for those sorts of things. The other popular cleansing agents that naturals use are clays. It's not as strong as a surfactant. Clays do similar to surfactants in the sense that the clay traps dirt and oils and so on in the clay itself, and then you rinse it off. Everything else in a sense is one big category because everything else should be moisturizing. Of course, you want your cleansing products to also have moisturizers, but you definitely want your conditioners to be moisturizing. So the first category in moisturizers are humectants, which is a must for me and my low porosity hair. Humectants attract water from the air or from while you're rinsing and your hair is wet, and they help keep water in your hair longer, which of course keeps your hair hydrated longer. We have the aggressive humectants like glycerin and sorbitol, which will very quickly pull the moisture from your hair if the air is drier than your hair. And then we have the film-forming humectants, which are slower to evaporate. So they form sort of a protective barrier on the strand, so that even if the air is dry, there is somewhat of a barrier between the moisture in your strand and the air. Those are my year-round ride or dies: honey, aloe vera, okra, slippery elm, Irish moss. Most ingredients you can think of that are moisturizing but also sort of thick or mucus forming, etc. Those tend to be film forming humectants. And those are my favorite. I find them to be more moisturizing than glycerin. Sugars are also humectants. So for example, honey and fruit extracts are humectants. So when I see fruit extracts, could be any fruit, guava, pineapple, any kind of fruit extract, just bring them, come. Because they contain sugars, and sugars are humectants, and my hair needs humectants because it's low porosity, and humectants are tiny enough to penetrate the strand and bring and trap the moisture in there. So yay for humectants. My love for my humectants. My favorite ingredient after water is humectants. The mucus type humectants are also good for slip, so you're just completely winning. So if you use something like, say, okra or marshmallow root or even flaxseed, you're getting your moisture, you're getting your slip, you're getting your humectant, it's film forming, so it kind of traps the moisture in longer. So to me, those are like super ingredients. But let me stop raving about humectants. I love humectants. Y'all know that. Okay, let's move on to another category. Then you have your emollients, which help to trap that water physically in by forming a thin surface on the strand, and some even slightly penetrate the strand, like oils and butters and so on. Of course, you don't want to have too much of that, especially if you're low porosity. Basically, you want to use the minimum of it that you can use and still have your hair be moisturized. So basically, you shouldn't have emollients on your hair if the water has escaped. That means you had too much emollients on your hair. You should have just the right amount so that by the time your emollient evaporates or wears off, your hair is ready for moisture and then another tub of emollients again. Emollients help to soften the strand by again having that nice slippery layer on the strand. The lighter emollients are like fractionated oils and triglycerides. Then you have the oils, which you know come in various lightness, heaviness, penetrativeness and sealantness. You know, some oils are very light, some are very penetrating, some are more sealing, some are more softening, like form a nicer feeling, a nicer textured film on the strand. So there's a whole range of oils. After the oils, you have your fatty alcohols, like the acetyl alcohol and so on, which are a little bit heavier than oils, but not usually as heavy as butters. And those are the ones that form the basis of your conditioner. Basically, you have your fatty alcohol mixed with water at a high enough temperature and it cools, bam, basic conditioner. That type of conditioner is more of an emollient just to let your hair feel nice. But in terms of natural hair and hydrating, you also want some bit of glycerin or some bit of humectant as well to actually penetrate, hydrate, and keep that water in longer. There are definitely ingredients you can look for adding slip. So the natural slip ingredients, as I mentioned, are the type of mucus ingredients. Anything that, you know, forms a little bit of slime on it. And again, that would be like the okra, the flaxseed, marshmallow root, Irish moss, slippery elm, ingredients like that. Those are natural and provide slip. There are also synthetic ingredients that add slip. For example, polyquartz and silicones and so on. I definitely look for slip ingredients as well when I'm reading through. Hold for a natural is just holding your style longer, basically holding the hair in place. So when you wet your hair and you shape your hair, you disrupt the hydrogen bonds in your hair, which kind of changes from its natural normal curl pattern into either a more defined or whatever shape you wanted to give it. And hold is that thing that keeps it in that disrupted state and doesn't let it revert to its natural state. Some great hold ingredients for natural hair would be pectin, would be various gums, xanthan gum, guar gum, would be flaxseed and chia seed, things like that. Also, okra and aloe also provide light hold. The gels that I use tend to have a lot of pectin and gum, like xanthan gum. But I also do like DIY flaxseed, and I'm experimenting with chia seed as well now as a natural hold ingredient. They give you the hold, but they also give you slip and moisture. Like I said before, just win-win-win. Then we have our chemical hold ingredients like carbomer, the various types of cellulose, copolymers, and so on. And those work, but for me, they don't add much moisture to my hair. They don't add much softness to my hair, anything like that. And also, they're kind of cheap, so I feel like products that include those should be priced to suit. So that's why I'm not buying like a $15 Miele or TGIN gel where the gelling agent is carbomer or copolymers and so on. Not because they don't work, but because it's overpriced for me, basically. So that's another element of ingredients for me, is what are the value of these ingredients and how does it compare to the value of the product that you're selling. I don't get flakes a lot at all, so I don't really think about that much, but a lot of these whole ingredients work by leaving a slight cast on your hair in that particular form. And when that cast gets old, it can start to flake off. So that's one way that you get flakes. If you tend to get flakes with one type of ingredient, and you've tried it in all different formulations, maybe try a different type of ingredient. Of course, the other way to get flakes is just kind of a bad mix of products that coagulate strangely on their own, which is kind of like the immediate wet and dry day one type of flake, which is another ingredient issue, I guess. But for me, since most of the products that I use are rather light and water soluble and so on, I don't tend to get into that issue where they're not playing nicely together. Since they're all supposed to be hyper soluble and easy to rinse and, you know, easy to mix, they all tend to play well together. So it's like using one big same product, even though I'm using two or three different products. But if your regimen is different and you use a lot of synthetic products and you use a lot of sealing products like silicones and mineral oils, then you'll have to be really careful about flakes as well. We have a couple special mentions. One is protein. So I did like two huge long videos on protein, so I'll definitely link them down below for you to take a look at. But just really quickly, you have moisturizing proteins like silk and milk proteins that are just there for moisture. They can provide slip and shine, and they're not there to strengthen or harden your hair in any way. So even if you think you don't like protein, if you see those ingredients, you should still be safe in trying it. I know some diehards will tell me they don't even like silk and milk, but kind of side eye, but you can generally at least try it. Then you have the kind of medium proteins, which are keratin and collagen, which are strengthening, but they are also very tiny and tend to penetrate the strand and don't stay outside as much to make your hair hard. Of course, if you use a lot of it, it's still gonna pile up and make your hair hard, but those can be gentle in certain cases. And then you have like the grain and vegetable proteins, and those are more strengthening. And I do believe in protein. Again, take a look at my huge long videos, but basically your hair is made of protein. Protein treatments are good. Find the right one for you. Find the right strength protein treatment for you. Don't do it too often. Have fun. Help prevent breakage. Check out my videos. Besides protein, there are other types of treatments. There are other ingredients that are there, not necessarily to add to that whole moisture chain I mentioned before on styling, but to add various other benefits. So for example, tea and coffee have caffeine, which helps reduce shedding. And then there are various Ayurvedic herbs, which also help to strengthen the hair and add shine and define your curl and various other things as well. And also there are things like rice water and chibe and so on that have various properties that are also helpful to the hair. And also stimulating ingredients like peppermint and other essential oils and so on that stimulate the scalp, any kind of tingly feeling and so on. Those are good for the hair as well and good for the scalp as well and can help to stimulate growth. So I give it a little props when I see them as well. pH is definitely important to me. The hair has a pH of about 4.5 to 5.5. So generally you want to use products within that, let's say, you want to use products within, let's say, that's 4 to 7 range. And of course you want your final products, your conditioning product, to be even lower, like into that 4 to 6 range, to help keep your cuticles lower, which helps to protect them and keep them on your strand, which helps to prevent breakage. I tend to assume, for the most part, that the bigger brands are pH balanced, but the smaller brands, especially if I see ingredients like soap, if I see ingredients like apple cider vinegar, if I see ingredients like clay, I tend to just take note and say, okay, maybe I would need pH strips, or maybe I would need to email the owner and just ask them about the pH, just to make sure that they are within the pH range to maintain a healthy hair. The final classes that we have are preservatives and stabilizers, which I won't go into too much, but I try to use something that's definitely broad spectrum and going to protect myself from bacteria and germs and so on, but something that isn't as harmful to humans or the least harmful as possible when looking at preservatives. So things like DMDM, I don't go with. I try to avoid those. So those are in pretty much every single cheap conditioner in the US, so it's really hard to avoid them. But I try to avoid them where possible and just use them for rinse outs and not keep them in my hair. So I do try to look for products that don't have DMDM or the bromo or the or urea and things like that, because they're not adding any benefit to my hair for sure, and they also can be kind of risky. I don't really need that in my life, so I try to avoid it. Things like silicones and mineral oil, I wouldn't call them detrimental to the health, but just for my low porosity regimen, I try to avoid anything that's sealing or clogging. So polyquat silicones and mineral oil, I try to avoid just for my low porosity hair. But it's something that you might be fine with. I want to see certain ingredients in my product, but I also want to not see certain ingredients in my product. This video is already stupid long, so I'm going to try to just wrap it up quickly and just tell you how to put it all together. For example, cleansers, I look for surfactants or clays. Your leave-in should definitely have water as the first ingredient. If it has water, then a humectant even better, like water than aloe vera juice. A film forming humectant is better for that high up, just because, like I said, glycerin is moody. So if it does have glycerin, I prefer if it's not in the top 5 in the ingredients list. Of course, the leave-in is the first thing that you apply to your hair. Water and humectant first, some emollients, definitely some slip. After that, you can apply your cream, which can have water first or not. and even more emollients like butters and oils. Definitely good to also have slip. You can have whole ingredients in your leave-in or your cream, that's fine. But you definitely want to have whole ingredients in your styler or gel if you're that kind of person that wants whole ingredients. Some people don't care at all whether their products have whole or not. For me, I wouldn't say I care a lot, but I want to know so that I can know how to move. Because if it doesn't have whole, it's probably not going to get me through the week if I'm doing, let's say, a wash and go. So if I'm doing a wash and go, I want to know how much whole my product has to know how to plan my week. If I'm doing a twist out or braid out, it doesn't really have to have whole. I'm okay with that. I wanted to give you a demo of how I go through ingredients, although I guess you guys probably see me do that a lot, so you may not even need this demo. But let's say this is how I pick up a product. I pick it up, I glance at the front. I'm not looking at any other promises. I'm glancing at the front just to see basically what type of product it is. Is it a conditioner? Is it a leave-in, a cream, a co-wash, or what? That's all I need to know before I just skip to the back. So if you tell me you're a cleanser, I'm looking for surfactants or clay. Otherwise, I'm looking for water, humectants, emollients, and slip. And hold is a nice perk as well. So that's it. That's the summary of my process. I hope it was helpful to you. Let me know if you have any questions down below. I also have a blog post on ingredients, so I'll also link that down below. I hope this video helped you to understand ingredients a bit better and know what to look for a bit more and just how various types of products should be formulated and so on. I will help you to pick products that work better for you in the future. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one. Bye.